Sorry, everyone, for our little technical hiccup, but I think we're underway, and I want to welcome everyone to the South Carolina Planning for Dam Emergencies, Collaborative Technical Assistance, Homeowners Association's Dam Safety Technical Information Series. That's a mouthful. This is webinar session 4, and this is titled Unique Considerations for HOA Dam Owners. Today's July 7th, and it is the last in our series. We have some housekeeping items. If you're having any technical difficulties, you can email Alicia at yources.com, and Alicia can help get everything straightened out. This webinar is being recorded, and it will be placed on DHEC's website in the future for the benefit of all dam owners in South Carolina. Phone lines will remain muted until the end of the presentation. Please use the chat function of Zoom to log your questions. And we will try to, we'll try to compile and answer as many questions at the end of the webinar as possible. If you do use the chat function, make sure you select all participants so that everyone can see your questions or your comments. And then lastly, if your question is not answered during the Q&A, you will be contacted after the webinar, and we will try to provide you an answer at that time. And with that, my name is John McCain, and I'm with South Carolina DHEC with the Dam Safety Program. And I just again want to thank you and invite, and welcome you to this fourth webinar that we are putting on, cooperatively with FEMA and the National Integration Center at FEMA, the National Dam Safety Program at FEMA, and Argonne National Lab, a contractor for FEMA. And just to again reiterate, thank you for on behalf of all of us. We have a really a lot to cover in this a lot to cover in today's webinar, and I do want us to get going, and we're going to have to move quick between speakers. But I do, I do want to ask if y'all will be patient, and if you do have questions, and if you are willing to stay a little beyond the 2-hour time limit, I believe, if we will stay online and on the webinar as long as, hopefully as long as we can and need to, if there is good conversation and good questions being asked, we are prepared to stay beyond the 7:30 in time, but that's all I have to say, and I want to turn it over to Lawrence Flynn to discuss special tax districts. Lawrence, it's all yours.
Really fast, I apologize. We did have a comment in the chat that the slides were not moving, so I just wanted to ensure that people are now seeing them move. Can I please have one of the attendees note that in the chat so that you are seeing the slides move now.
Yes, they're moving.
Perfect, thank you. Okay, Lawrence, do you now have access to the slides?
Alicia, I appreciate that. My name is Lawrence Flynn. I'm an attorney with Pope Flynn Law Firm in Columbia, South Carolina. Until October of 2015, I knew very, very little about dams, dam safety, or greater HOA law. It's amazing what disaster will do to pull folks together to come up with options. And happenstance as it may be, Wesley Grayville, who is on the presentation panel today and will be given a little brief introduction about his dam facilities, the reason that I came up to speed. He was good friends with the county, and they were having a discussion over at the bar convention right in the aftermath of the 2015 flood, And on the basis of that, they started talking through what some options could be to figure out potential recourse for rebuilding the various dams that blew out along the Gills Creek Corridor in Richland County as a result of that flood event. And so I do some work for Pickens County, and Wesley called me, and long story short, we figure out a process to be able to have a number of homeowners associations along the Gills Creek Corridor, as well as some in other areas of Richland County, create special tax districts to basically serve as a buttress to the homeowners associations that own the various dams. And the reason for that, and Dan Lott will probably get into this in a little while in his discussion of the homeowners associations, is I like to tell folks that the creation of the special tax districts as a vehicle or a potential alternative to financing the improvements necessary for various dam improvements is kind of an operation in the homeowners association that in many times owns these dam facilities. And the reason for that is that the special tax district as a vehicle is really not there to own the asset. It doesn't intend to take over ownership or control of the facilities. It is simply a means of getting around the limitations of the homeowners association's documents that don't allow for master lien or master assessment authority in their chain of title. If you were to create a new master subdivision today, you know, there are developer attorneys out there that know this process really well, and you buy the property, it comes with certain rights and restrictions that are attributable to the homeowners association to levy and collect fees that are then enforceable and can be foreclosed upon. It just so happened that these dam districts or these homeowners association communities along the Gills Creek Corridor and frankly throughout the state didn't have that master lien assessment authority built into their homeowners association documentation. And so as a result, Wesley came to me with a problem to figure out how they could go about assessing the proportionate cost of rebuilding their dam facilities among all in their community and do so without having to amend, you know, everyone's chain of title to allow for master assessment authority. Because while everyone was generally in agreement that they wanted to get the dams rebuilt, they were not in agreement as to how the costs would be paid, how the costs would be allocated, and who would be responsible for those costs. And so the kind of necessary next step was figuring out a way by state law to create a special taxing district that basically would overlay the properties and the communities that that actually own the dam. And so I'll use Wesley's group in particular, the Upper Rocky Ford Homeowners Association. They contacted me. They were the first one to go. And I think subsequent to that, we created upwards of six by the time it was all said and done along Richland County. And really the vehicle here was similar because we'd done similar things in Spartanburg and in Lexington, typically in relation to sewer improvements. And so if y'all flip to the next slide, I think just as a brief introduction here, Alicia, I don't know if you can move it or if I have to move it, but I can just wax poetic if we also need to just run through them. But
yeah, you have access to the slides right now.
Okay, great. I'd say all that. Can you just flip it to the next page? Let's see. Perfect. Can we go to the next one? So just a couple of brief slides that we've pulled together that can be kind of a benchmark for folks as they may be thinking about doing something similar. State law permits counties as the local governing body in various communities to create special tax districts. The authorization for special tax districts came in the Home Rule Amendments to the Constitution. Y'all may have heard the term home rule, and the idea there is to the local government provider in those particular areas. Historically and prior to home rule coming into effect in South Carolina, we had this process of the legislature creating special purpose districts. And so the necessary analog to that in under home rule is the creation of special tax districts. And so there's three versions of which you can do. One is a taxing district that consists of the entire unincorporated area of a county. That obviously doesn't work in this circumstance because these are limited particular dam areas. You also have the ability to create a special tax district through a freeholder petition authorization. There's some question as to whether or not this section is legal because you're tying voting rights to land ownership. And then the last one is what we used along the Gills Creek Corridor, is this 15% petition and referendum method where you generate a proposed district, the district being a fancy term for just a kind of consortium of houses that we, for our purposes, identified around the various lakes. And 15% became a really low threshold for purposes of being able to identify the creation of the district. And if you'll flip to the next one, Alicia, I think you can actually move to a different slide. You can go to the next one as well. So what is the actual process for creating the tax district? And petitions, which are signed by any qualified elector, meaning that if you had 20 homes, or we'll make it a little easier, say you had 50 homes, and each person had two owner-occupied voters there, that gives you 15 potential participants that could petition, two petition participants per home that could potentially sign, because you could have a spouse and an adult child, or any number of folks that would be eligible to vote. And as long as that is their place of residence where they're registered to vote, of those 50 units, you get, say two or three, you need to get 15% of the qualified electorate from the proposed district to petition for the creation of the referendum, petition for the creation of the tax district by referendum. And if you were to do that, which is exactly what happened in our various communities, you then submit that petition in a qualified format to the county. The county then accepts it. Now, obviously, you want to make sure that you work through the process of working with the county to let them know in advance that the tax district was something you wanted to create. And obviously, Richland County was looking for a potential vehicle to assist and potentially help the folks that had been affected by the flood, also recognizing ramifications of widespread property tax appeals and the effect of the property adjustments as a result of those appeals, gave them some reason to give better consideration to the acceptance of the petition. But once petition is then accepted, county council approves it, it gets submitted to the election commission in a referendum. And if the referendum is held and duly approved by a majority of the registered voters in that area, and again, if you had 50 homes and 100 registered voters, you had a 15% petition, and 25 people of the 100 showed up to vote, and it passed 13-12, that is a sufficient process for purposes of meeting the voting provisions to create the district. It seems that it gives a small number of people the ability to dictate the terms of what you need. But it was an efficient vehicle for purposes of being able to create these dam districts. And by their terms, we then identified amount of money that could be borrowed and amount of annual ad valorem taxes that could be put in place, or annual fees that could be levied for the purposes of the limited purposes of rebuilding the dams. And so each one of the districts that we created was approved by a referendum, was then ultimately created by ordinance of county council to create the various taxing districts, and then assign an operating body, which is basically a governing body that we just so happened to tie to the governing body of the various homeowners associations for purposes of approving the operations going forward. And we thought that was a necessary nexus, because while you had the tax district now in place to levy and collect taxes in an amount sufficient to pay for these various improvements, and in Gills Creek Corridor dam districts, all of that was done to be able to levy and collect taxes, mostly to finance and defray the costs of the various SBA loans, the Small Business Administration that lent emergency funds to these various districts to be able to repair their dams. And so it then became a financing vehicle to levy and collect taxes and to finance the cost of that reconstruction. There's also some operation and maintenance authorization built into all of the various districts that have been put in place. But that authorization is going to obviously be dictated by the terms of the referendum question as approved by the voters as well as county council in creating the organization. So I don't want to run too far afield here. I know y'all have a long litany of speakers today, and I think the idea was just to kind of give a general sense of what special tax districts were and how they were created, what the vehicle could ultimately be to get them accomplished, and hopefully that accomplishes this purpose.
Hey, Lawrence, thank you so much. We do have one question, and since you're about to leave, maybe sure. If you had a chance to address, if you can look in the chat, there's a question from Peter Rogers.
Okay, let's see. Chat. Sure. Can these special tax districts include properties not in HOA communities but are downstream of the dam or could be affected by the dam's proper functioning? The short answer to that is yes. And in fact, with respect to Lake Dogwood, that's what we did. There is a bit of a political question that comes into effect here because the statute does not dictate or state that you can only create a taxing district around the areas directly benefited by the dams. And Donna Sheehan is also on this call today, and she could answer this question probably as well as anyone about the politics of how you structure the financing or how you structure the levy in a way that is politically acceptable to be able to get a sufficient number of voters to approve it. And so if you had properties that were affected downstream, and they are not actually, you know, receiving the benefit of the water that's being dammed up north of them on the river, you're probably not going to get them to vote for it. But if you had a sufficient number of voters in the taxing district above the dam and you just included downstream users, you obviously could get them in, you could get it approved. Then you deal with the political like they're receiving a benefit, you know, potentially coming to petition the county council, which is what we had in many respects with respect to Lake Dogwood. They were a bit of a different organization simply because the community was so remote that everyone that was in that area was generally deemed to have the benefit of the lake, even if you weren't directly attached to the lake. And one of the things that we wrestled with and was something that, you know, maybe a conversation for a greater day, is that by state law, taxes have to be levied on the basis of a uniform assessment, meaning that you can either levy taxes tied to the value of property, which means that you actually then have to go in and particularly identify and assess the costs of the taxes against the actual values of the property that are receiving the benefit, which the county was a little hesitant to do simply because they didn't feel comfortable levying taxes only against the real property. And so instead we implemented a uniform user fee, and it was very hard to distinguish categories for the uniform user fee that were different among certain property payers than others. So everyone pays a flat assessment in Lake Dogwood, regardless of where they happen to be located on the lake. So I would say that the limitation here is simply the structure of the initial petition and the properties that originally request to be put in. But then obviously, if you know, the more attenuated you get from the, you know, particular problem at the heart of the matter, which would be typically those properties that are going to be adjoining the lake bed, you're going to have more political irons in the fire that you're going to have to address as you move forward. And don't let me sell this short. This is a very political process. It takes selling your community. It takes selling the county auditor. It takes selling the county treasurer. It takes selling county council. And then you also have to get the votes to be able to actually pull the district together. And so the process is indeed very political, but to answer that question, downstream of the dam, yes, you could absolutely put them in the tax district. And not to belabor the point here, but I see there was another follow-up question about who collects the taxes. In the structure of the special tax district, the way it works and the reason that this structure works so well for the purposes of not only servicing the loans with SBA, but also making sure that everyone was going to, you know, that was obligated to pay was going to pay, is that the fee or the taxes that you levied through the special taxing district get put on the annual ad valorem property tax bill. So for those of you that are used to paying property taxes, which I assume everyone that's on the phone would certainly fall into those categories. The way property taxes work is for real property, you get your property tax bill in the fall. It comes in October or November, and it's due by January the 15th. Well, this special tax district is no different. The levy is going to go on your ad valorem property tax bill. So it would be levied by the county auditor, and then it would be collected by the county treasurer. And then to the extent that someone decides not to pay, there's a statute at state law that states that the county treasurer may not issue a tax receipt unless all fees, taxes, and other charges levied on a tax bill are paid in full. Meaning that if someone decided, hey, I'll pay my Richland County property taxes and my City of Columbia taxes, but I'm not going to pay this special tax district levy, that would then result in their property being moved into forfeited land or foreclosure proceedings and ultimately sold on the courthouse steps like any other delinquent tax property. And that's the ultimate hammer in this entire process. And frankly, that's a really good question. I'm sorry I glossed over that or missed that earlier. Because the whole benefit of this process is that you have the county doing the levy and collecting on your behalf. You don't have neighbors enforcing tax collection proceedings against other neighbors. You have the county doing it in their normal course of operations. And that's ultimately the, you know, if you were going to boil down the benefits of the special tax district and salient point, that's it. It's that you're not doing the levy and collecting and you're not responsible for doing so. You know, one, you know, you could create all of these authorizations and various structures through just your regular homeowners association process. What you can't do if you don't have that master assessment authority, or even if you do and you're required to go through a foreclosure process to, you know, exercise some type of lien authority against a delinquent property taxpayer. In this case, you have the county doing it for you. And because they already do it every single year and they know the process for levying, collecting taxes and selling your property on the courthouse steps if it's not done, that's really the all-encompassing, most important point of the entire tax district structure.
Well, thanks. Thank you, Lawrence. That's great. And I know you've got to go, and we're going to appreciate your insight and expertise. I'm going to, I guess, Michael.
Thanks, guys.
Michael Train. Yeah, thank you, Lawrence. And Michael, take it away.
All right. Thank you, John. Hey, everybody. I'm Michael Trainum. I am special counsel with Nexen Pruitt out of their Columbia office, practicing primarily in the environmental and administrative law group. I had the unique privilege for a number of years to work at DHEC, first as a staff attorney with the Bureau of Water, and then later on as chief counsel for their environmental team. And one of my many duties there was in advising the dam safety program. So I hope that I'll bring a little bit of insight to the discussion here tonight, along with the rest of my panel. Let me see if I can advance these slides. Nope, I think I messed that up. Alicia, can you help me out?
Hey, Michael, see where, yeah, click on resume slideshow. Yep, there you go.
All right. It is, there we go. All right, it's advancing now. So we had to call a little bit of an audible on the presentation order tonight, or the agenda would have been earlier, but obviously you've already heard from Mr. Flynn on special tax districts. The overview of tonight's presentation, I'll try and provide a little bit of a framework and context for the entire discussion at a 30,000 foot view. And then our panelists are going to kind of go through their own unique experiences, a lot of them from 2015 and the aftermath, and some from subsequent event experience. But we'll be talking about a number of funding mechanisms, liability and insurance. Obviously, you've heard about tax districts already, how to best utilize covenants and bylaws in association to preserve your dam asset, and just hear generally about some lessons learned and other stories from the past couple of years and what we have experienced in South Carolina as far as dam infrastructure. is slowly advancing, I guess. Or maybe it's just not going to cooperate with me at all.
Yeah, try using your keys if the bottom toolbar is not working, or I can advance for you. It's up to you.
Yeah, I'm actually trying to use the keys, and it does not appear to be doing anything.
Okay, let me just take over for you.
All right, that'll work. And there you have your outcomes. You can go ahead and advance. All right. I distinctly remember when I joined DHEC and was being introduced to the various clients that I'd be working with directly and the program staff. The dam safety program at the time I joined the agency had, I think, 2 full-time employees. And there were a number of regional inspectors and staff members who shared some dam-related responsibilities as 1/10 or 1/4 or something like that of their job responsibilities. Needless to say, the dam safety program was understaffed. And this was an issue that DHEC was aware of and had brought to the attention of the General Assembly long before the 2015 storm. But I do remember being told early on in my time with the agency, these are the dam safety staff. You'll probably never hear from them. It's a very quiet program. Next slide. You all know exactly what happened next. If you've been in South Carolina for any length of time or sat through any of the prior webinars, you're familiar with the events of October 2015. Hurricane Joaquin was a game changer as far as dam safety is concerned in South Carolina. It never made landfall, but it dumped over 20 inches of rain in parts of the state, caused 19 deaths, closed hundreds of roads, and caused 25 outright dam failures. Now, as I mentioned, DHEC had already requested the personnel and the funding from the General Assembly for additional personnel for dam safety, but it really took this event to kind of get the issue of dam safety front and center before the legislature and get the approval for the funding that would eventually bring the dam safety program up to strength and where it is today. At the time of Hurricane Joaquin, unfortunately, the agency really had to beg, borrow, and steal personnel both internally from other programs in DHEC and from other state and federal agencies to try and get boots on the ground immediately after the storm and assess as many of the state's regulated dams as they possibly could. Ultimately, they found hundreds of dams with some degree of damage, and 75 dams were so badly damaged they required emergency orders requiring the lowering of water level and other emergency actions. South Carolina learned a lot about its dam infrastructure as a result of flood in 2015. As you may have heard from other webinars, in general, dams in South Carolina are earthen structures. They're not armored, and they are, in general, more than 50 years old. That's true across the United States. Our dam infrastructure in this country is aging. It's predominantly more than 50 years old, which means just as a matter of aging, it's more susceptible to failure. It also means that most of the dams in South Carolina were built before there were any defined regulatory standards. We learned that a number of dams in South Carolina were misclassified and potentially more dangerous than we realized. And we also learned that many dam owners were ill-prepared for the financial responsibility of repairing a dam or keeping it in good order, which continues to be a challenge today. Next slide, please. HOA dams in particular are somewhat unique in the regulated inventory of dams. I'm painting with a very broad brush here, so your mileage may vary. But generally speaking, HOA impoundments are an aesthetic asset. They are built because they look good and because they increase the property value of residences in the vicinity of the impoundment. Sometimes they're used recreationally for swimming, boating, fishing, just kind of depending on the size of the impoundment. They may also be used by waterfront landowners as a source of irrigation. They're not, as a general rule, working pond, the way agricultural or industrial impoundment would be. But also because of the vicinity of, or the proximity, I should say, of residential structures to association-owned impoundments, they are quite frequently high hazard. South Carolina classifies dams according to their hazard potential, much like any other state that regulates dams. We have three tiers of hazard in South Carolina: high, significant, and low. Hazard classification has nothing to do with the condition of the dam, everything to do with the possible consequences should the dam fail. So even if you have a dam that is kept in the best condition possible and is highly unlikely to ever fail, sunny day or in a major flood, if it were likely to hurt or kill someone because of its failure, it's still considered high hazard. Thus, when you've got a lot of houses around an impoundment, you're likely to have a high hazard dam. What that means as a practical matter is that association-owned dams that are high hazard are going to have a higher carrying cost over the life of the asset than other regulated dams would. They have the highest design criteria. They are inspected the most frequently. They're simply more expensive to maintain. So they do have that potential financial liability. And there's also liability associated with potential failure. So HOA dams do present some very unique challenges and questions. Next slide, please. One of the major legal issues that we ran across in 2015 and thereafter is who actually owns the dam. It's not unique solely to HOA dams, but we did see it quite frequently in dams that were located in associations. And what I mean by that is that oftentimes the HOA bylaws were completely silent as to dam ownership or maintenance responsibility. And when you look at the actual property lines, you know, there is no real community property surrounding a particular dam. All of the dam may be divvied out amongst residential parcels, such that two or even three homeowners might end up owning portions of the embankment of a dam, and another property owner owns the outfall. And the way the statutes are written in South Carolina, you have to look at every structure or pertinent structure, is the way it's written in the statute, to determine who owns the dam. And it's very, very possible to have multiple dam owners. So we often had a real question: who's actually owning this asset? Even where the HOA had the foresight to write something in the bylaws about maintenance and operation, or maintain that property that underlies the dam as common property, or reserve an easement, there's a question sometimes whether the HOA has sufficient access. Can they get in, or is the dam effectively landlocked? How are they going to get in to operate the dam? Or more importantly, in an emergency situation, how do they get heavy equipment in to make emergency repairs? Many of the dams that were threatened by Hurricane Joaquin and Hurricane Matthew required very heavy equipment and the quick application of riprap just to preserve the dam and keep it from failing. So, you know, answering the question of how you're going to get those pieces of heavy equipment into place is something you definitely want to answer before a hurricane is bearing down on you, not during. The million-dollar question for most associations, though, was simply, how are you going to pay for it? As Mr. Flynn already alluded to, and as we'll hear from other folks, does the HOA have sufficient funds or funding mechanisms in place to pay for dam upkeep, or in a worst-case scenario, to rebuild the dam to reestablish the asset that the impoundment? So that's something that we're going to hear more about from some of our other speakers. If we have the opportunity at the end of the presentation to take some questions, I'd love to hear from you. But please feel free to email me directly if we don't have the opportunity to get your question here tonight. Thank you so much.
Before we move on, just a note to all the panelists, please make sure that you are speaking loud and clear into your mic or into your phone, depending on what you're using. And we are getting some feedback that some of the volume seems to be going in and out. So we just want to make sure we're speaking loud and clear. With that, Don, you should have access.
Okay. So, hi everybody. I am a community insurance specialist for associations located in South Carolina, and I happen to live right on the border of South Carolina. I live in North Carolina, and I've been a community insurance specialist for over 20 years now. Our headquarters is in Easton, Pennsylvania, and we write insurance for several hundreds of associations located in South Carolina. So we can start with the slide one. The next slide, thank you. So today we're gonna talk about insurance coverages that are available for community associations in relation to their dams and their dam exposures. I wanted to start off on this first slide in connection with Title 49, Water Resources and Drainage. And this is in connection with the state of South Carolina Code of Laws. What I think is very important here is that number two, which I've highlighted in white, that the owner or operator of a dam or reservoir is not relieved of any duties or obligations or responsibilities or liabilities arising from or incident to the ownership or operation of a dam or reservoir. That is very important to know in respect to what legal liability the association may have in the maintenance, operation, and ownership of a dam. So on the next slide, I'm going to review a little bit about general liability insurance. So general liability insurance is very common for community associations. Every community association has in their governing documents that they're required to carry liability coverage. General liability is third-party coverage for bodily injury and property damage that occurs to others. It is not damage to the association, but damage that may occur to a third party, such as a neighboring community association or downstream businesses or homes. Typically, the minimum limits of insurance for general liability are $1 million per occurrence. It's typically first dollar coverage, meaning that there's no deductible. The general liability policy is going to provide defense of bodily injury and property damage claims. That's the cost of having to have an attorney defend the association from any claims. It also provides indemnification should there be any type of dollar amount assigned by a judge in a settlement. There also could be punitive damages included with your general liability policy. I put in a little section here about dam contractors. If you have anybody that comes in to service or to maintain or to review the specs of your dam, you should always obtain a written contract prior to them coming onto the association's property, indemnifying the association and holding them harmless, and also including the community association as an additional insured along with the community association manager. On the next slide, I'm going to discuss a little bit more about property damage. So the commercial general liability policy, every single policy that has an ISO form states that the insurer, which is the insurance carrier, will pay sums that the insured becomes legally obligated to pay as damages because of bodily injury and property damage to which this insurance applies. The section about duty to defend. An insurance carrier has a duty to defend the insured, who is the policyholder, until they do not. So what that means is if the insurance carrier has any specific exclusions stated on an insurance policy, they will defend you until they have made notice to the insured or the policyholder that there are certain applicable exclusions and therefore coverage may be denied. Further, the commercial general liability policy, as I stated earlier, does not apply to the property that you own, rent, or occupy. Property damage is further defined under the commercial general liability policy as physical injury to tangible property, resulting in a loss of that property. It also includes loss of tangible property that's not physically injured. And those loss, those type of claims, they would be, for example, we could have intangible property, which would be electronic data. Tangible property tends to be the physical buildings and other auxiliary structures that may be associated with third parties, including not only a home, but it could also be business property and contents. On the next slide, I want to get further into what liability concerns an association may have and why it's very important to advise your insurance carrier and your insurance agent about the potential for liability in connection with owning and maintaining a dam. So quite often, our association board members are concerned about injuries to trespassers, fishing, boating, swimming hazards, oftentimes spillways and their weirs and eddies, there's fast currents. It's an attractive nuisance to children and minors. A lot of children want to explore those areas. There's usually some dense brush around there where somebody could become lost. They could become injured. We're also concerned about downstream property damage and, of course, loss of lives. The insurance carriers want to know about your emergency action plan, the purpose of your dam, construction type, what controls are in place, the dimensions, current dam inspections, population density, the economic impact, flood zoning, and then pollution risks. Property damage, including vandalism that's incurred by trespassers. The commercial general liability, again, is not going to provide for loss of property to your own dam. That is going to have to be insured under a property policy, and depending upon your dam type will dictate insurability for earthquake or difference in conditions policies. We also have concerns about liabilities of uninsured or underinsured contractors and subcontractors. Poor risk transfer. Do you have a written indemnification plan in place with the contractor? Is there a transfer of risk from the association to the contractor who is doing the work or the maintenance? And this is important, and Peter Miller from Miller Dodson will get further into this topic, but failure to reserve funds for insurance deductibles, capital improvements, and maintenance. Oftentimes I get asked, how much insurance should the association have? What is the amount or the limits of insurance we should have? And I always say, how much can you afford to buy? Explore liability limits as much as you can purchase from the carrier they're willing to offer. If they can offer in excess of $50 million, then you should look into purchasing that. On the next slide, I want to talk a little bit more about potential claims that could result in denials of coverage. So insurance is never going to pay for willful gross negligence or willful non-compliance or failure to adhere with local and state and federal laws. And that's very important because South Carolina does require that dam owners follow certain procedures and have inspections performed regularly along with their emergency action plan. There's also willful non-compliance with insurance requirements. So some insurance policies specify and I get further into this a little bit, perhaps you may need to have life safety equipment, proper signage or written warnings. Oftentimes we want to see signs posted that everybody can see in a designated area, warning them of hazards or danger. And this was spoken about by Michael earlier, dam owner or co-owner not being properly named as a named insured on a policy. Oftentimes, an insurance agent who does not specialize in community association may not look to the governing documents to see if there is an easement or if there is any allowance for another association or a sharing of the land. We want to make sure that all names are on the policy that need to be. In the event that there's a claim, if that name of that owner is not on the policy, they will be denied coverage. This is also very important. A designated premises location specific endorsement. If the general liability policy only lists a specific policy location of ABC and damage occurs at XYZ, coverage could be declined. Further, we look to, is there security fencing? Is it maintained and inspected for breaches? If not, the insurance carrier could deny the claim. Infrequent or lack of inspections. If an ongoing hazard or a danger to others is not taken care of immediately, the insurance carrier could say that you were negligent, you didn't take corrective action in a timely manner. That also leads into maintenance. If you do not maintain the dam, the insurance carrier could potentially deny coverage. And as I spoke about earlier, not following your emergency action plan, in compliance with your reserve study, contractors, always making sure that they're properly vetted. And I put a section in here about bonding. If you're going to be having any work performed on a dam, it's important to verify that your contractor has the financial wherewithal and means to complete the work that they stated they would complete in the contract. So bonding is something that hasn't really occurred too much in our industry in the last couple years, but now that we're in some economic downturn, I would think that that's very important for a community association to look for a bonded contractor. And last but not least, criminal acts, war, pollution, and breach of contract are often excluded from the general liability policy. On the next slide, I just wanted to review a couple more important exclusions that you may find on your general liability policy. Always review your general liability insurance policy when it comes from your insurance agent. There's a special page in this first couple pages of your insurance policy that says forms, endorsements, and exclusions. And that's basically a summary title page of all of the pages that are included in your insurance policy, those several hundreds of pages that you get. It's a quick one-page overview of all the exclusions and endorsements providing coverage. I wanted to again review the designated premises endorsement. This is actually an exclusion. It is stating that the insurance is only going to apply for bodily injury and property damage arising out of the ownership, maintenance, and use of the premises shown in the schedule and operations necessary or incidental to those premises. Now, a dam, the overflow and spillway, that can, and if there's flooding that results, it can actually extend further from the premises where the insurance is covering. So it's very important to look at your policy and see if this designated premises endorsement is included. And if so, check with your insurance agent to see if you can have that removed. On the next section, the next slide, I wanted to review very quickly umbrella liability. Umbrella liability is where you're going to get an increase in the limits of insurance. It is similar to your general liability. It's excess over your directors and officers, your hired and non-owned auto liability, employer's liability, and portions of workers' compensation, which is a portion of your workers' compensation, and it could be excess over your pollution liability. We recommend limits for a dam of at least $25 million minimally or greater, again, by what you can afford. It should be follow form general liability, meaning that it mimics the same coverages that the general liability has. You need to also further review the exclusions, the terms, and the conditions of the insurance policy very thoroughly. There was a question here about acts of God, flood, and 20 inches of rain. Now, if there is a dam failure that is from an act of God, you may not be legally responsible, but the insurance company may still defend you from potential lawsuits. Every claim is not mutually exclusive, meaning that there's always going to be potential for some certain type of exposure or situation that has occurred that makes the claim different from any other claims. So, for example, a burst pipe, there could be reasons why a pipe burst, right? There could be a failure to maintain the pipe. The pipe could be old. The pipe could have frozen. The pipe could have expanded. So the same with dams, there could be several reasons why the dam failed and was breached, causing property damage. On the next slide, I wanted to be very specific about property coverage. Property coverage excludes flood unless it is endorsed. So those community associations that may or may not be in a flood zone, they can still purchase flood insurance. But it's important to know that if the property policy does not have a flood endorsement, water is excluded. There is a caveat though. If there is a fire or explosion that or theft that results in water damage, then the property policy would cover it. Flood, sinkholes, mudslides, and earthquake perils are excluded unless they are specifically endorsed to the insurance policy. And the next slide, in connection with earthquakes and difference in conditions, a lot of people think that South Carolina, especially in the upstate, does not have the potential for earthquakes, but that's actually not true. And you can actually go online and see that there was even a recent earthquake, and it was only 1.0 on the Richter scale in central South Carolina just a month ago. Earthquake is important if you have a dam. So if there is a dam that suffers an earthquake and the earthquake then causes a breach or a failure, you may want to look to see if you can insure the dam for earthquake so that you can replace the dam. Those coverages typically run anywhere between $1,500 to as much as $25,000, depending upon the cost to replace the dam. There's typical deductibles of 2%, and I say per building, but it'd be per dam or structure or per occurrence. And then the difference in conditions is expanded coverage for perils that are typically not covered by your insurance policy. It fills in the gaps. So for example, landslides, sinkholes, and mudslides, those would be covered under a difference in conditions policy. Mud flow would require flood, because flood insurance through NFIP would cover mud flow, or under a difference in conditions policy. And that's essentially it, everybody. I'm available for further discussion, and I'm going to remain on the webinar in the event that there's any questions that come up in connection with dam claims. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dawn. That was very, very interesting and educational, especially for me. I think we're going to move into a new section on more on anticipating improvements, repairs, and specifically on funding mechanisms. And Alicia, I think Peter Miller, I think it's you're up.
Thank you, John. My name is Pete Miller. I'm a reserve specialist. Our company works throughout the Mid-Atlantic states, and we do approximately 550 to 600 reserve studies a year. I want to talk to you about reserve studies and how they apply to dams. We've heard two speakers so far, Michael Tranum and Dawn, both talk about liabilities when the maintenance isn't done on the dams. Does the HOA have sufficient funds for upkeep and replacement? Dawn said there may be exclusions if there's failure to reserve for capital expenditures for repairs. And there's a recognized way of of anticipating this and planning for these replacements. Alicia, if you've got control, would you go to the next slide, please? So when we talk about reserve funds, reserves are set aside for the replacement and major repair of common elements in a homeowner association or condominium. So they provide that funding mechanism. They also provide for the cost to be spread equitably over time. In other words, everybody that lives around that dam and gets the enjoyment of the waterfront or the increased property values pays their fair share towards the replacement of some of these things. One of the things that this does is it reduces the need for special assessments, but it also provides us with a safety net. Next slide, please. So many of these things, and I'm using swimming pools here as an example, many of these things that we're going to be replacing are very, very expensive. We can talk about spillways that may be $250,000 to $500,000. We talk about corrugated risers that may be $25,000 to $50,000. These things particularly have a long life expectancy. And the problem is that when we start plugging this in, when we have risers that that have such a high cost and such a long life expectancy, there's a tendency not to include those in our reserve funds. And you'll see a lot of reserve studies specifically exclude anything that has a life expectancy of more than 30 years. And let's just, as an example, take a riser that costs $500,000 and has a life expectancy of 50 years. If you're calculating this in a reserve fund, what you should be doing is calculating it so that in 30 years, you've got 3/5 of the value of that riser. Now, the other issue that arises here, no pun intended, is the fact that many of these structures are already 25, 30, 40, 50 years old. So what we have to do is look at what the effects of accelerating those replacement reserve costs. Alicia, next slide, please. So what happens is when we put a remaining useful life on each of these things, they will appear someplace in these calendar pages. And again, this is a sample reserve study. And you'll see in the bottom right-hand corner of each of these calendar squares is a projected total. We're not saying that you have to do all these things in this particular year. We're saying this is when we feel it's going to be prudent to have the money available. Next slide, Alicia. So what happens here is we see that over time, there are some years where we have zero expenditures, some years where we have expenditures that exceed $1 million. The idea here is that we look at what the average expenditure is over time. Next slide, Alicia. And then we look at how these expenditures accumulate over a period, in this case, a period of 40 years. So what we're looking at in terms of these accumulated expenditures is how much money do we have to put into each year in order to be able to not only meet these near-term expenditures, but to meet the longer-term expenditures. And so the reserve study will say each year as part of your normal budget, your annual budget, you need to be putting X amount of money into the reserves for all of these common elements. And what that does is it helps satisfy the need for the long-term funding and make sure that everybody's paying their fair share as we go along. Because the alternative is that the people that live there the longest or the new people that have bought into the community are going to be paying an inordinately large share of what those replacement costs are. The other thing that this does, and if we look at the first 15 years or so, and we see that when we're funding at the level of those red circles on that line, we're actually building up an excess of funds that are earmarked for future expenditures. So those accumulation of funds provide us with a bit of safety net. So if something does happen and we have to spend more money than we anticipated in those years, we could go back and look at this cash flow spread and say, okay, do we have the funds available that we could borrow from the reserve fund so that we don't have to have a special assessment? Typically, this is done with the board of directors resolution that says we're going to be borrowing X amount of money from the reserve fund for X reason, and we're going to pay it back over a certain amount of time before it's needed. So when we're establishing a reserve program for HOA or a condominium, we're looking not only at the near-term expenditures, but also what those future long-term expenditures are. And again, if we're calculating over a 30 or 40 year period, and the item that we're replacing has a much longer life expectancy, we don't wait until that that item drops into this 30 or 40 year window. We simply apportion how much we should have in the reserve fund by a specific time. So if something has a life expectancy of 50 years, a remaining life expectancy of 50 years, then at year 25, we should have half of that value put into the reserve fund. I know this is a quick overview. I'm trying to help us make up a little bit of time, but I'll be available for chat as we go through, and I'll certainly be sticking around after this is over. Alicia, I think that was the last slide. Thank you all very much.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Glenn Calk is our next presenter. And Alicia, you'll control the slides. Glenn, are you ready to present?
I certainly am. Thank you. Thank you, John. Good evening. My name's Glenn Calk. I've been practicing real estate law for 25 years, 21 years of which I've been with Nelson Mullins. During that time, I've had the opportunities to work with various entities in connection with various aspects of dam ownership. Two of the most recent events, though, those deal with associations seeking to get dam loans from the United States Small Business Administration, or SBA. Interestingly, the SBA was created to help small businesses and probably was not initially created to provide emergency relief. So, you know, you ask the question, well, why seek an SBA loan? As others have mentioned on this call, many associations and other entities lack $1 million in the bank or $2 million in the bank as a reserve necessary to repermit, redesign, and reconstruct a replacement dam. Similarly, the association may be relatively small or comprised of members that can't raise $1 or $2 million with a special assessment to rebuild its dam. A lot of folks will say, well, why not go to a bank? And my experience with banks have been they either are uninterested in making a long-term loan, want to look at what collateral the bank might be able to take as collateral. And in most instances, an association's assets are not necessarily lucrative or attractive to a bank to take as collateral. For example, why would a bank want to own a dam in the event that it had to enforce on the loan transaction that it entered into in the event of the association, the association failing to repay that loan? And then lastly, if the bank, you know, were willing to make a loan with little or no collateral, it's very likely to charge a fairly high interest rate. So all of those, you know, instances tend to make the association, you know, uncomfortable borrowing money from a bank in order to fund the reconstruction of a dam. On the two transactions that I've worked in on most recently, about which I'm talking today, the SBA made loans of approximately $1 million to one association and nearly $2 million to the other association. The terms of those were 30-year terms with an interest rate at 2.625%. So this is why the SBA is an attractive choice in this type of circumstance. The downside to using the SBA is that the SBA is not particularly fast in its processing of these loans. And I'm not, you know, an apologist for the SBA insofar as that, but I know that others have experienced significant delays in connection with seeking to get dam loans from the SBA. So I may suggest some reasons behind it, but I will tell you that, you know, the borrowing associations that have had to deal with the SBA certainly have some stories to tell, and I think we'll even hear about one of them later on. The first association I helped started its process in October or November of 2015, immediately following the flood, and did not get the first funds in the SBA loan until March of 2017. So, you know, 18 months to 2 years. Now, of course, Hurricane Matthew in 2016 actually may have impacted SBA's ability to respond insofar as it was then undertaking to make loans in connection with Hurricane Matthew. And the second association, as I mentioned, will be discussing that as well. However, I would guess in that instance, the 2018 Hurricane Florence floods, 2019 wildfires, and the earthquake in Puerto Rico may have somewhat overwhelmed the SBA staff insofar as making these relief loans. Similarly, my guess would be, here we are in 2020, and SBA has been saddled with making PPP loans. And so again, I imagine that the SBA may be slower in being able to respond to the associations as they apply for these loans. But I think one of the takeaways would be, if you start the process, that you should stick to it, be patient, and ultimately, I believe it will, you know, happen. It has with my two associations that I've been working with, and I would encourage you to, you know, to do the same. If you would advance the slide, please, I'd appreciate it. Assuming that your association does decide to apply for an SBA loan, you need to initially look at the requirements under your bylaws and your covenants. You want to see if they're recorded. You want to see if membership in the association is voluntary or mandatory. Clearly, if it's voluntary, you may have some issues with members agreeing to pay association dues necessary to service your loan. And so that would be a significant issue. With respect to your authority to create liens or establish a special tax district, as Lawrence mentioned earlier, you want to make sure that your corporate documents allow you to do these things, or that you have appropriate meetings with board approval and member approval to authorize those liens, entry into the loan documents, et cetera. You want to make sure that your meetings, you know, that you've got appropriate notice, quorums, votes, minutes, and you really just have to carefully perform those meetings in order to ensure compliance with the bylaws and covenants. I won't talk much more on that because I think Wesley may later on in this presentation, but that's kind of an overview of some of the things that you need to consider. Please advance the slide. Thank you. I'm not going to go through all of these loan documents, but I do want to point out, you know, there's a slew of them up here, and the reason why is the SBA has created a program, and it's going to be very steadfast or is going to stick to these documents. You just need to understand that the SBA is not going to be particularly flexible. It's got boxes to check, and it will insist that you do certain things. I do want to talk just a second about the mortgage. As was mentioned a little earlier, you want to make sure the association owns the dam that's being constructed or reconstructed, as the case may be. And as we've talked about before, there are instances where, you know, an association may be surrounding the pond, but may not necessarily own the dam. Well, if it doesn't own the dam or it doesn't own the pond, then pledging that property as collateral, of course, is a real challenge. And the SBA, at least in my experience, has always required in these transactions that the property being improved, enhanced, or replaced be pledged under a mortgage. I think we've covered a lot of the insurance issues. Generally speaking, the SBA requires insurance on the thing being built with the loan proceeds and flood insurance on that. The issue here is, generally speaking, you can go to the next slide, please. Generally speaking, property insurance for ponds and lakes is not available. Property insurance, you know, not including earthquake insurance, as we just learned, but general property insurance of a dam is not generally available. And SBA requires it nevertheless. And so what we've learned in this process is, to the extent that your insurance underwriter will issue a statement that your dam and lake or pond is not insurable, that will in fact, or that property insurance is not available on those, will generally satisfy the SBA. One of the nuances that you'll find in the SBA loans is that a legal opinion is required, and true to form, SBA has a form legal opinion, which many lawyers shy away from, including myself, and that is, you know, a substantial, or requires substantial negotiation, and, you know, understandably, may take a little time to work through, but I do want to, you know, at least let you know that to the extent that you just say, well, my friend John, you know, can handle the transaction, John needs to understand that, you know, there's some legal opinions that more or less put John on the line with respect to the undertaking and the transaction involved. One thing that we've talked about is lien authority. And what the SBA does with respect to lien authority is the SBA is a lender and it wants to make sure that it's going to be repaid. So to the extent that the loan is intended to be repaid by association dues and payments by the members, the SBA requires that the association has lien authority. And what that means is if your neighbor does not pay his or her association dues, that the association will place a lien on the neighbor for failure to pay and ultimately foreclose on the property that the neighbor owns. And the SBA insists that that be in place with respect to association loans. Now, to the extent that the association utilizes the special tax district program, then there is a way that there is no lien privilege that is kind of pledged or agreed to be somewhat assigned to the SBA, but rather the SBA gets comfortable that another governmental entity will collect those assessments, or in this instance, taxes, and allow the repayment of the SBA loan. The last piece that I'm going to talk about is title and survey issues, and we've kind of talked about this a little bit. You know, you want to make sure that the association actually owns something that it can pledge under that mortgage that we talked about. And surprisingly, a number of associations seek to fix a dam only to find out that only the two owners on the end of the pond where the dam is own the land on which the dam is situated. And so certain circumstances like that, you know, require modifications to ownership and other types of actions to get the association in a position that it can take the loan out from the SBA. Survey issues are similar in nature. Quite often, if it's a large pond and the association actually owns the pond, SBA may require that the entire pond be surveyed. And that's an expensive undertaking simply because, you know, it's a large piece of property with not a lot of straight lines on the survey. So the surveyors, you know, have to spend quite a bit of time and effort to make those surveys in order to satisfy the SBA's loan requirements. So again, those are the types of things that an association seeking to take a loan out would need to think about and to perform in order to do this. I could go into much more detail, but you know, in an effort to try to get back on time, I'm going to yield and appreciate your attention and encourage you to ask questions to the extent you can.
Thank you. Thank you, Glenn. And our next speaker is Dan Creed, an engineer with a very unique perspective. I do want to ask all the panelists, just make sure you're speaking directly into your microphone. There has been a bit of kind of the audio comes and goes occasionally. So just, you know, please just kind of make a conscious effort to, you know, speak into the mic. And I think with that, Dan, are you ready?
I'll start. I am.
Okay, take it away.
Thank you, John. I appreciate the opportunity to be with y'all and some of you I've been with for a while. We are a small firm here in Columbia that has worked with dams throughout the state for many years and have had the opportunity to help HOAs not only prior to 2015, but during or as a result of the 2015 and subsequent hurricanes, and dam owners as we move into a new regulatory climate. Certainly, we're not going to address everything or even hardly anything in 20 minutes, but I have selected a few topics that in kind of a lessons learned kind of approach that I wanted to speak about that I hope will be of value to you. If there's something that I haven't touched on, certainly my email address is there, and I'll be glad to try to answer that or find somebody that can. You as an HOA board member or committee person are charged with maintaining and preserving the asset that very often impounds the most important factor, that being the lake, in the collective value of neighborhood property. You must strive to extend the life of the asset, not only to defer the cost of upcoming repair or rehabilitation, but also to minimize that scope where possible. In addition to the physical condition and design lifespan of the various dam components, the scope of this rehab will be impacted by evolving regulatory policy as we're learning now. Next slide, please. When I was a young engineer in 1989, inspecting dams for the Land Resources Conservation Commission, I heard this the first time. I'm certain that everybody at DHEC has heard it many, many times, and I think many of you HOA board members have heard it when you told somebody that the money needed to be raised. It's unfortunate that the very asset that is so critical to the retention of property value as well as quality of life that to which your community is accustomed is invariably taken for granted. Many of your neighbors may not realize the dam even exists, that there's just a pond there. Moreover, dams do not get better with age any more so than a bridge or a road or a building or any other civil infrastructure. And the impact of an extreme storm event on a dam is subject to many more factors than are readily apparent. So just like any other investment, past performance of your dam cannot be relied upon as an indication of future results. Next slide, please. The goal then is to manage, to the extent possible, the scope and timing of repairs so that they are performed as a planned project controlled by the HOA and not in response to a failure, near failure, or regulatory directive. And of course, there's many, many components to the dam, but I want to touch on a few that tend to cause the most issues. The first is a corrugated steel spillway conduit. If you have a corrugated steel, not aluminum, but steel spillway conduit, and you'll recognize it because it'll look galvanized or bituminous coated or frankly rusty and pitted, then it is either near or beyond its lifespan and needs to be addressed. It needs to be evaluated and addressed as soon as you're able. Concrete lined auxiliary spillways, you think that concrete is something that's robust and strong, and it is, but it also, if not properly designed and constructed initially, and many of these weren't, it also tends to hide issues that don't become apparent until there is a failure or a near failure. So the maintenance of a concrete spillway channel, repointing joints, and that kind of thing is extremely important. Earth emergency spillways cause issues primarily due to degradation, by frequent flow, which makes maintenance of that spillway and maintaining a full pool elevation difficult. It is difficult to repair an earth emergency spillway in a way that has any kind of life expectancy, and if left unchecked, can lead to head cutting and severe erosion, which is extremely expensive to try to deal with. The vegetative management, certainly there is a much greater focus from a regulatory standpoint on trees on the dams. If you have trees on the dam, you're already aware of that. And so not only is that a cost which must be planned for, and in my experience, will work with you on that, but you also don't want to put yourself in that position and need to be maintaining the vegetation on your dam now. Low-level gates, I'll briefly touch on, because Steve Cunningham will have a good presentation on the operation and response to emergency situations or forecast heavy rainfall events. But make sure your gates work. Make sure that that they will function when you need them to, and that they will close when you need them to. And again, the last point, similar to what I said about Steve's presentation. Operate your dam in a proactive manner that enhances the protection of the structure. Next slide, please. As is the case in nearly aspect of life regulated by bureaucracy or government, regulations typically continue to grow and encroach, and with dams, that was accelerated certainly by the response of the legislature and DHEC following the flood of 2015. Policy and regulations have changed and will continue to change, which will impact which aspects of a dam must be addressed, how they will be addressed, and when they will be addressed. Again, it's changing in inspection emphasis items. It used to be that you noted trees on a dam and said keep an eye on them, and you really ought to take them off. Now the word is, or your directive is, you need to take them off. Also, there since 2015, there is a much more streamlined and consistent approach to the tolerance for uncorrected deficiencies, and failure to comply will inevitably result in orders being issued and action being taken. That's not a position that you want to be dealing from. The design criteria really have not changed significantly, with the exception of seismic, but certainly it is being applied much more arduously, it appears, than it was prior to 2015. DHEC, fortunately though, it appears is considering the value of rehabilitation versus replacement, which if a dam owner can proactively monitor and respond to the condition of structures, can be a much more cost-effective way to deal with a problem, and may ease some of the criteria constraints. Perhaps the largest one that I wanted to speak about is changes in hazard classification. Two aspects related to that. One is the DHEC policy that dictates since the flood that if a road downstream carries more than 400 vehicles a day and would be inundated by a failure of the dam, then that dam is a high hazard dam. That would be a dam that formerly would be a significant hazard dam. The second part of that is a much more robust and conservative approach to modeling and breach parameters to determine or to develop inundation mapping. The hazard classification is important for several reasons, but it is primarily important because a high hazard dam has a much greater spillway design flood requirement. And you will generally be going from having to pass the 100-year flood, which may be 8 or 9 inches of rain in 24 hours, to passing the half PMF, which is half of 40 or 45 inches of rain, the runoff from 40 or 45 inches of rain in 24 hours. This is, there's ways to deal with that or to try to mitigate that, but that has potential to make it infeasible for you as a dam owner to comply with design criteria in the event you have to repair your spillway to the extent that DHEC believes you must comply with that design criteria. When you get that letter in the mail, don't put it back in the mailbox. Make sure that you get with an engineer to understand that you know the ramifications of what that letter may mean. Finally, you know, other regulatory agencies, can also impact how you might repair it. Typically, this would be environmental regulations associated with wetland boundaries, wetland buffer boundaries, which limit your ability to make changes to the embankment, or flood mapping or the flood management, which has the potential to limit your ability to not only raise the dam or modify spillways, but also in some cases the amount of water you're allowed to discharge, which is a discussion for another day, but is a particularly difficult position. Next slide, please. So we've heard a lot of good information about how are we going to, you know, how are we going to fund this upcoming project or necessary project. Now, the difficult part and where a consulting engineer can help to a degree is developing that project budget and execution horizon. Being able to develop that cost in order to permit realistic budget planning is obviously important, but can be difficult depending on the nature of the project and the circumstances in which it is being developed. Likewise, an evaluation of when it will be necessary to commission a project is also difficult. How much life is in that pipe that already looks bad? While engaging an engineer by no means removes uncertainty, doing so can provide HOA leadership with information to make informed decisions. Next slide, please. We have met with many HOAs and HOA boards in living rooms and around kitchen tables, particularly since the flood of 2015, and have shared distressing news that no one was prepared for. The criticality of the dam structure to property values and your neighbor's lives does not necessarily resolve the ability to retain the structure. It's not too big and not too important to fail. Again, it goes back to being proactive and trying to be prepared to deal with these kind of eventualities or possibilities. Next slide, please. So let's look at a few of the different project types briefly and those budget considerations. Routine maintenance and minor repair. That's stabilization, growing grass, cutting small vegetation less than 4 inches that need a permit according to the DHEC. And erosion that is less than 12 inches deep doesn't require a permit. That all that type of work needs to be arrested and addressed prior to it needing a permit. When you go to a permit, you're in a whole different ballgame. Planned capital projects typically would be a spillway replacement or rehabilitation. It could be tree removal from the dam. It could be valve replacement, depending on, or gates, depending on whether or not it's large enough to not be able to be handled with routine maintenance. But these are projects that that have been identified, the horizon has been estimated, and it's with the assistance of an engineer, you've got some semblance of a budget and can plan for it. Obviously the worst is an unexpected major expenditure, major being as compared to the reserves. We've all seen that. And the heartache that brings. And then the fourth which is also important, is that the regulatory criteria are minimums. You may decide as an HOA that you want to armor your emergency spillway, or you want to protect your embankment from overtopping, or that you want to increase spillway capacity, or that you want to improve embankment geometry, if for no other reason than to reduce maintenance costs. Those are also, should also be consideration for you as a board. Next slide, please. So how do we get to determining an idea of what that budget number is? And it could really take many different forms. It really depends on what the issue is. It could be as simple as the engineer telling you, yeah, we did that 2 years ago to a similar dam and it was $250,000, or it was $50,000. And you may decide that that's good enough for you to start planning from, or you may decide that you want to commission some preliminary engineering work to get a little bit better handle on the horizon and the expected budget for that. So we start with, you know, we need to acquire existing conditions information. This could be a video inspection of your pipe. It could be a survey. It could be a wetland study. Any of those kind of things to help identify or to serve as a basis for estimating the scope of the project. As the engineering progresses, it may be necessary, even in the preliminary phase, to bring in other consultants to address constraints other than civil. Again, this could be wetlands. This could be geotechnical. To assess what the soil conditions are in and beneath your dam. It could be structural engineers, and it could be a flood consultant. But with this information, we try to develop, or your engineer can develop, an anticipated project scope and put it on paper so that it can be understood. You know, the level of detail that you may or may not one is based on the complexity of the project and your tolerance for budget precision. But at the end of the day, you're looking for a document which gives you some sense of reliability, or at least as to the scope or the expected scope. And not only can you and the engineer review this, you know, a contractor can look at it and give you some feedback as well regarding the what an appropriate budget might be. Keep in mind that this is not a document that you bid. You don't shop this all over town for four or five folks. You deal, or perhaps with the assistance of your engineer, deal with a reputable contractor. Don't take his time. Get his input. And this is, you know, we're not shopping his number. We're just asking for input. Next slide, please. This is where the engineer starts making excuses about why this project cost a lot more than he thought it would. There's many challenges in trying to estimate or forecast the cost of the project and the timeline, a lot having to do with the nature of the project. You know, typically with funding constraints and regulatory, various regulatory agencies, it's a long time from project conception to the construction drawings and the construction contract, and certainly the construction market can change, or as number two, the dam itself can change and erode further or have further damage or any of those types of things. You also have concealed conditions that may not, you know, you as an HOA may not want to spend $15,000 to dial in on the geotech during this phase of the project, and that's fine, but you have to understand that there's a contingency associated with that. You know, there was a dam, and this is about 10 or 12 years ago, a dam in Aiken County in a subdivision that had mill in the name, and there wasn't any mill. Well, when we went in there to replace the spillway pipe, the contractor found a mill. So those kinds of things make it difficult. Those concealed conditions make it difficult to fully reduce the risk associated with concealed conditions, and we'll address that in a future slide, although we'll try to hurry up. Also, you have regulatory responses and requirements vary. They continue to put this together, and sometimes you run into issues that the during the submittal of final plans that weren't raised during the submittal of discussions regarding conceptual plans. design components. You know, it may be that you, the embankment constraints may be affected by the spillway size or the geotech, any number of things. And then the last thing I'll talk about too, everybody wants to have this done as quickly and get water back in the pond as quickly as we can. And certainly there are ways to do that. You may elect to move forward with a flood study or a geotech now, but that could be a $50,000 expenditure that could be changed as you get into final design. So there's a risk associated with that. But at the end of the day, the cost of a project developed as part of a planned budgeted process can be estimated with much greater accuracy than a project initiated as a result of a sudden change in conditions or regulatory directive. Again, be proactive, be prepared. Next slide, please. All right. I'm going to use this as an opportunity to discuss the execution of the project, often undervalued by consultants and the regulatory community, and yet another source of risk for the HOA. We consultants like to get a picture taken in front of the project at the end, and as do a few regulatory folks. But at the end of the day, the contractor is the most important part. Next slide, please. We get this quite a bit in dealing with an HOA. You want it fixed fast, cheap, and without risk. Well, we don't get all three. We generally get one, and we often get one and a half. But how this is approached has a lot to do with the success of the project. Next slide, please. Again, the contractor has such a critical role. His familiarity and understanding of items peculiar to a dam, pipe bedding, for an example, is critical. The manner in which he will meet means and method challenges, such as control of water, difficult conditions, staging access, also is paramount to the success of the project. I'll run through a few things here quickly, but from a bidding process, you as the owner need to discuss with the HOA or your management company who is going to handle the bidding. It needs to be done that is fair to all invitees. We don't need, somebody's brother-in-law was fine to bid on it if he's qualified, but he needs to be bidding on it at the same time as everybody else. If you as an HOA get the reputation that you're shopping somebody's number, nobody's going to want to do it. You clearly need clear contract documents for that. And really what you're looking for at the end of the bid is a few low bids that are tightly grouped. And there may be outliers, but that's not uncommon. Some folks will give you a number, but are just hoping to get it for that number and may not be that interesting. Value engineering in quotation marks is not a deviation from plans or specs, but if you have responsive bidders who want an opportunity to leverage their strengths, whether that's sheet piling or concrete work or some other type of approach that could save money, then and still fulfill the obligations of the plans and the specifications, then they need to be given, or they can be given an opportunity to demonstrate that. That needs to be done typically after the bid is received, but before a bid is awarded. And it's important to give those, if somebody wants to offer another approach for the engineer to meet with them, understanding that he recognizes the proprietary nature of that approach. The construction contract, you won't get into, clearly it needs to be an owner contract that's reviewed by your counsel, by your engineer, and probably by your insurance company. But I do want to touch base on risk and on the allocation of risk and scope. You can tell the contractor that we want you to be responsible for everything, no matter how you encounter it, and he can do that, but the cost of the contract will be enormous. So you have the risk associated with existing conditions. Typically, we give the contractor an opportunity to inspect the site and provide him the existing conditions information that we have, and it is his responsibility to examine the site and determine if any other conditions have arisen which could impact his bid. Subsurface conditions. You as an owner may say, I don't want to spend the money on a geotech. Well, if you assign that risk to the contractor, then you will have paid more than that geotech cost in his covering of his risk. Another way to handle this with the geotech, with the information from a geotech, would say, would be to create an allowance that you might say, we anticipate the possibility of encountering 2,000 cubic yards of unsuitable material. Include that allowance in your bid, and then you're getting, you're establishing unit price, and you're doing it in a way that affects the low bid. You would also may want to consider relieving the contractor of some damage to property constraints. It may be that you can fix it cheaper than he can and better, and need to just add it to the project cost. And if you don't remember anything outside of this part of the session, oftentimes the contractor will advise you or will offer to you that if you'll handle the grassing, I'll cut X out of the contract. When you do that, you're letting the contractor off the hook. You're going to be responsible as a dam owner for having that site, for having the dam grass, and to the satisfaction of the engineer and the DHEC. When the dam's built and we've got a little bit of milk coming up, it isn't done. And without that hook and without that retainage to get the contractor to finish it, you as an owner, it may be a larger task than you envision. Next slide, please. Finally, just a few words on membership dynamics and management of expectations. And clearly, y'all know more about membership dynamics than I do. But you know that some folks may oppose a project because they don't want to incur the cost, and some may oppose the project because they can't pay the cost. And those are all legitimate positions. And sometimes, and sometimes that's the appropriate, I mean, that's the will of the membership. Sometimes it seems like folks just oppose to oppose. And this create, you know, this is an opportunity, a dam project is an opportunity for past issues to resurface. However, others may have a better, what they think is a better idea to fix it, and may not support the design. In our experience, those points need to be vetted. They need to be addressed. Number one is perhaps it is a better design or a better way approach. And number two, you have also explained to your client and your client's community why this approach is necessary, and it helps with buy-in. The other thing that I would point out is with an HOA, you need a single consistent voice when dealing with engineer, regulatory agencies, and the contractor. That would seem to be evident, but it doesn't always work out like that. Project cost and duration. This is what I have learned as well. The first number and start date is what is remembered, regardless of how you qualify. Right? When somebody says, just give me a ballpark, that number will haunt you to the grave. And then finally, the completed project. Sometimes there's some expectation that scope outside of dam repair would be completed. This could be, you know, the reservoir bed. It could be removal of sediment. It could be adding fish. It may be that the scope that the community has an expectation for a broader scope than what the dam repair is. It may be also that the community doesn't fully understand what the plans show, and they may say, you know, I thought the fence would look nicer. The riprap looks ugly. You know, why does it, you know, why do I have to look at this concrete, you know, spillway, those kind of things. And then, you know, finally, you know, this is an opportunity when you complete the project to, you know, to maintain what you've done, to preserve that investment, and to recognize the lessons learned, which frankly at this point are probably seared forever in your brain. So, at any rate, I appreciate the opportunity to speak with y'all, and I'll stick around to the end if there's any questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Dan. And we are, you know, I know we're running close to the end of time. We've got a couple more speakers to present. We are unfortunately going to have to cancel our roundtable discussion, our Q&A session. So please submit your questions and we will respond to them after. But we are going to go, we're going to go ahead and power through and get through the rest of our speakers. So Wesley Graybill is our next speaker. Wesley, you want to go ahead and take it away?
Wesley, if you're speaking, we cannot hear you.
Sorry, it helps to turn off the mute. Okay. I've been sitting here a long time waiting to talk. So can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. My experience is sort of a case study in everything that has been discussed so far. And for that reason, I'm not going to go into huge detail on a few things that have been covered already, but I'll touch on them. But I'm a member of the Upper Rocky Ford Lake Owners Association board, have been for about 12 years, but I also happen to be a real estate attorney who has worked on infrastructure documents for associations like the one that I'm a member of, even though the one I'm a member of was formed many, many years ago and had lots of flaws. So we were a 22-acre lake with 68 owners on the lake, and our HOA owns our dam, but we are a voluntary association. I knew this going in when the flood happened in 2015. I knew that it was a voluntary association beforehand, and so when it happened, I knew we were going to have problems because I knew we had to have financing, and I knew what it was going to take to get the financing, obviously things that Glenn touched on before. So I knew that we did not have lien authority. If you could go to the next slide, please. Okay, this is what I was looking for. Okay, so this is a portion of the original deed to our lake back in 1955, and it purports to put obligations on the owners to maintain the dam and repair the dam. But this was only recorded in the deed, deeding the real estate to the association, or at that point it was a corporation, but it was not recorded against the various lots, and therefore there's no way to enforce this. So I knew that going in, and then we had to start working on things. We immediately started working on trying to get an SBA loan, like the one Glenn talked about. And I knew we were gonna have to have revamped authority documents to do so. So I started working on those. Quickly realized, though, early on the process that we were not going to be able to get all 68 of our landowners to agree to lien their property. So we started trying to figure out another way to go. But the SBA still wanted us to go through the steps that we ultimately went through to amend this restriction here to beef it up, to mention lien authority and other obligations. And we also amended our bylaws to deal with assessments and special assessments that were very poorly spelled out beforehand. But then we also went on a dual track. We started pursuing the special purpose tax district, which Lawrence talked about, which was an idea he and I kicked around early in the process. And you know where that ended up based on what Lawrence said earlier. So we ended up doing all those things. We hired Dan Creed, who just spoke before us, talking about reserves. We thought we had a lot of money when things started. We had about $50,000 in the bank. And we thought, hey, you know, we've got a lot of money here before the flood, and you know, we don't know what we're gonna do with all this money. Well, end of the day, we ended up spending about $1.6 million on a new dam. So I would say, to heed the advice of trying to get some reserves going, and that's going to serve you well. If you would go to the next slide, please. Right, these are some of the things I just touched on about amending the deed restrictions and imposing annual assessments and special assessments. We were really unable to do that on a property-wide basis, even though we did do it on paper. And that seemed to satisfy the SBA, believe it or not, something that Glenn and I could talk about later. But we knew that that wasn't going to get the job done, so we ended up doing the special purpose tax district. So we knew that we would be able to enforce or force our landowners to pay their fair share of the cost of repaying the loan. Next slide, please. Right, this is, again, some of the things I spoke about earlier. Creating a lien obligation, the purpose of the assessments, the amount of the assessment, and importantly for us, we did set up special assessments, which we had to go to the membership a couple of times during the process, particularly early on before we were able to get the SBA loan, to raise money to hire people like Dan and like a lawyer. We ended up going outside and hiring a lawyer to help us with some of the modification of our authority documents and the SBA, because it was just too much for me to handle all of that, also being on the board. Next slide, please. Okay, some lessons learned in the process, and again, like I said, my experience is sort of a smorgasbord of all the different things that have been talked about beforehand. But during the dam construction process, I would say this is important for everybody to try to get everything done at once. Like in our situation, there was a water line that ran through our dam, which obviously busted when the dam went out. And after the dam was completed, after a year of trying to get the loan and a year of construction, we were approached by a municipality who wanted to run a water line through our dam and sort of dig it up after the fact, which was very disconcerting. We were able to work it out such that our dam was not affected by the water line, but always try to get everything done while it's being built back so that you don't have issues like that hanging around. Hiring professionals to assist you in the process is imperative. Again, like I said, we hired a outside counsel to help with documents and our SBA closing, and we hired Dan, who just spoke before me, who did a tremendous job managing our project and dealing with the contractor. Another thing that we discovered after the fact, which ended up being sort of a big problem, was, again, our lake was, we had a lake bed that was dry for a long time after the flood and the breaching of the dam. We had a great deal of vegetation that grew in the lake bed. And once the water was restored, it ended up being a big problem for a lot of people because you had essentially trees right outside your backyard. And some of us went out and cleared some areas before the water came back so that would not be a problem on an individual basis, but it should have been done more on a lake-wide basis. And it's really taken a long time to get that situation remedied through several efforts by the association. And we also think it contributed to a weed growth problem that we've been fighting ever since the lake was restored. Just touching on what I said earlier, and a lot of people have touched on, you've got to make sure your organizational structure is properly done, in place, and up to date. We learned the hard way and had to spend a lot of time and effort getting that done. Of course, it's all good now, but at the time, it was in pretty bad shape to when the process all started. Another thing that I really would like to emphasize is that it's important to have capable and competent people on your board, ideally from different professions, different walks of life. In our case, we were fortunate to have an insurance professional on our board, somebody who was a finance professional, somebody in construction, and then me as an attorney. And we had a core group who kind of worked through the process together to get this done. But you have to have people on your board who can deal with certain aspects of a project like this to get it to the finish line. And finally, I would say getting buy-in from your membership is a huge part of this. And Dan touched on that a little bit in the end of his presentation. We had 68 adjacent owners on our lake. We had several meetings where we explained the process to them about the tax district, about the SBA loan, about the construction. Luckily for us, we did not have a lot of dissension. We had a few people who tried to say they were not going to participate in the tax district, but that remedied itself when we explained that they were not going to have a lake and their property values were going to go down. And so eventually everybody came into the fold and we got a vote that carried the day for that project and that tax district to be passed and implemented. So again, though, communication with your members throughout the process is key to making sure you don't have dissension along the way. And luckily for us, they allowed us to do the job that we were doing and with limited interference. But that's all I have. We're trying to keep it short and keep things moving.
Okay, great. Thank you, Wesley. Donna and Jim.
Yes, hi, good evening. This is Donna Sheehan and Jim Morris will be joining me in the discussion. We're happy to be here to share our experiencing with repairing the dam at Lake Dogwood. And just to check, can you all hear me okay?
You're coming through loud and clear.
Excellent.
I can hear you, Don.
Yep. Okay, excellent. So I'd like to say that if our project could have a tagline, it would be hashtag almost but not yet. Next slide, please. And also I'd like to say many of the comments that were shared by Wesley and then previously by Glenn and Lawrence and Dan, I mean, we completely experienced them and we're glad that you shared them with this team. So from a Lake Dogwood perspective, just a couple of things you should know is that it's now breached, but it was the original concept dam to the Lake Murray. So it was a historic dam. And when it was filled, the lake covered approximately 200 acres and it encompassed a watershed area of approximately 54 miles upstream. Now our dam was breached like many of the others on October the 4th, 2015 by Hurricane Joaquin. Next slide, please. We're not the typical association, and by that I mean that our association was established in 2006, not in 2006 when the dam encountered an issue. It wasn't an association that was put in place when the housing area had been developed. So our association was laid on top of the existing structure. And basically, we were privileged that our documents were put in place with a lot of authority. And it allowed us to then purchase the dam itself from the owner, and we're able to repair the spillway and we're able to maintain the property on an ongoing basis. But like Wesley was saying, our membership is voluntary. And as of this point, you know, we have maybe 30% of the members who've joined the association. Our area is pretty broad. We have approximately 130 properties, and I think it's fair to say that it's a very non-homogeneous set of owners. And by that I mean we have large established homes, and we have smaller homes. We have properties that weren't developed, and we have even some church properties. So it wasn't, we have a diverse set of interests to take into account in repairing this dam. But the one thing that we did have in common, and it really helped us, was that by way of the previous deed, every property within our area is deeded access to the lake. So they all shared in the economic benefit, or they will share in the economic benefit of having the dam repaired. And that's been an excellent joiner, if you will, for us. So next slide, please. So this slide depicts my hashtag almost but not yet comment, in that this is the timeline since the dam's breach of the issues that we've contended with, and gives you, you know, chopped up into five separate segments, if you will, you know, what our actions have been. So when the dam was breached in October of 2015, we were able to take some immediate action. The good news was that we had an association and we were able to appeal immediately to the SBA under its disaster assistance program. We also hired Dan, and we were able to begin some plan design and explore various repair and design options. I'll go into the next one a little bit more in the next slide, but we did pursue the funding. We addressed the issues that we had with our documents. We appealed to the SBA, and we ultimately created an SDA to support an SBA loan, and that took place from 2016 to 2018. And I'll go into more detail with that. But once we received the, but concurrently, we were working on our initial plan design. So Heritage Engineering, you know, worked with many of those professionals that Dan had referenced, you know, including specialty engineering firms, with DHEC, with county regulators and other authorities. And also he worked with the homeowner most directly impacted by the dam design. This homeowner had a home located directly below the dam. But he was working on the initial plan design, such that on the next column, once the money had been approved, we were put in a position where we were able to put some bids out. Well, unfortunately, things change. We're talking about 2018 now, and time has changed. But the bids were put out, and all of them came back above budget. But Dan reworked the design based on some good input from a contractor. We revetted that design, and we bumped into some additional requirements. I don't know if you remember, but there was an earthquake that was referenced in a previous discussion, and we were asked to do some additional engineering study to determine what the impact would be of an earthquake. So, you know, people learned, and we were asked to to follow through on some of the lessons that had been previously learned. We also encountered some non-engineering delays, but ultimately we received a competitive bid, and we were able to go back to the SBA and modify that loan. Now we are addressing the issues and once again vetting the plan. Our non-engineering delays were favorably resolved, and the seismic testing was concluded, and Dan is currently working to adjust the design and embed it. So we're right now in the position where we can move forward again, fortunately. Next slide, please. All right, this is where the money is. We've been talking about financing. Well, in 2006, when we first encountered our first issue, several interested parties had paid into a fund, but mostly we had a Knight that stepped up and carried most of the expense. But we had the association in place, and we did begin to build some reserves. But in 2015, with the dam breach, costs were clearly too high. Our reserves had grown to only $14,000, and we looked at different grants and other opportunities to find funding. But the good news was that we did immediately file for the SBA disaster assistance under the association clause, which allowed us to get a very inexpensive loan. But we had estimated, through Dan's help, we had estimated that we would probably have about $1 million to repair in repair costs. Well, we were declined by the SBA. Now, we found them really easy to work with. Some of that that work that Wesley had described had opened the door, and we were walking right through that door, fortunately. But we couldn't, with a small percentage of association membership and the high potential cost of the dam, they declined us because we couldn't prove a repayment. Well, that's when we learned about the special tax district, and that worked out really well for us because, again, if you remember, we were a non-homogeneous group. We didn't really have, we didn't have another way to get the full community involved with the repair. And by involve, I mean really assured that they would pay. So the special tax district was a great solution. We had a bit of a long road to hoe. Our timing of having a year to get it done proved to be what we really needed because it was a little bit of a contentious process. But it was the best democratic and the best administrative option that we found. Well, originally our goal was to, because of the non-homogeneity of our group, we wanted an ad valorem. We want to pursue the ad valorem approach as opposed to a flat user fee. But we found that we were denied that that opportunity by the county auditor's office. And so we've stuck with a flat user fee at this point, which means that everybody, regardless of the value of their property, pays the same amount. But we did begin to collect under our special tax district as of October 17th, and we've been able to do so too in the last 2 years as well. Once we had the STD in place, we reapplied and we were almost instantly approved by the SBA for an amount that would cover the engineering costs. We had made it really clear that we would come back once we knew exactly what the full repair costs would be. And we have found that the SBA has worked with us, and we're right now in the process of finalizing the modification of mortgage to meet our actual expense, which is $1.8 million. So, as of March 2020, we had that approved, and we're still closing. We are finding that it's taking a little longer to get things done through the SBA because of some of those major issues, especially COVID-19. Is just eating up some of the time from the SBA. I'll turn it over to, next slide please. I'll turn it over to Jim, who can speak to you to some of the lessons learned.
Yeah, hi, this is Jim Morris. I'm not on the video, but I'm here. Let me just say, first, we had to get organized pretty quickly. We don't have a lot of people that were willing to step forward. But we had enough to get things beginning, and in fact that crew has stayed with us the whole time. We had to stay focused on our priorities. We knew certain things had to get done, and then of course we have this odd assortment of folks, and of course some people would always want to take us off into how many fish are we going to have and other sorts of things. So we always had to stop those and say let's solve that after we get a lake. And at this point now, given that it's 5 years, we're also going to have to resolve the trees and the brush, which we're looking at the parks, the folks, to see if we can't do a controlled burn. We do have a good team of, 1 to 3 action people who are working very well together. We really have to stay in sync with each other because it's very easy to get to suddenly lose track of what has been done. Just given the nature of things. The trust with the community is very important. We have been able to keep that trust, I think. We're very transparent. As soon as someone gets up, one flat earther gets up and talks about how, somebody might be running off at the money, we're pretty quick to close around it and say, look, what do you want? And we've got all the documents, here they are, et cetera. We don't want to assume that the community is aware because not everybody communicates out there. Not everybody has internet. Effective internet out there. We have problems with half the lake with kids on it. Some kids out there, and they don't have high speed internet, so they can't even do schooling at home right now. So we have plenty of challenges. And we, a few other things, additional things. We had some chemicals that were dumped. You may have heard in the news, they were dumped up upriver from us, and we had to go through that gyration to make sure that the chemicals had not done any damage to the lake, but they evidently just passed through. We also have a county road that goes right below the dam, and that road is being, we believe, the county has said, yeah, that's of no use to us now. It's an old road that had a little wooden bridge below the thing, and so that's we're taking care of that. But those are some of the key things. Everything takes longer than expected. I have probably three times stood up in front of folks and said, I think we're going to have this thing within, you know, 6 months to a year. And of course, we just had a meeting within 2 weeks ago, and I stood up and I finally, because there was a point in time where I didn't think we were going to get this done because we had easement problems, and somebody stepped forward and bought the property in question. And so now we're going to be able to get through that easement issue. But I once again said, folks, I think we're back on track, and I believe we'll see water within the year. So that's where we stand now. It is not simple, but I'd give us an 80% chance, 90% chance that we're going to get water in within a year, or water in. I can't say within the year. That's all I have now. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jim and Donna. Steve, you're up.
Okay, good evening. I'm Steve Cunningham, the current president of Spring Lake Company. It's always fun going last here. I'll try to make this quick. Spring Lake is in the Gills Creek watershed in Columbia that was hit hard by the flood. Fortunately, our dam did not breach, but it did suffer major erosion that required rebuilding much of the downstream slope of the dam. So we've experienced and been through a lot of what's been covered tonight, but what I wanted to do was cover the ongoing operation and maintenance of your dam. Either you've got an old dam that hadn't been affected by a flood or whatever, or you've rebuilt one, or you've got a new dam. This is what you should be doing to keep that dam in good shape. Actually, most of what I will cover was addressed in detail in the first two sessions of this series. So I urge you to go back and review them. There's a lot of good information in there. So next slide. This has been said, but I think we all know now that if we own a regulated dam, it's the greatest collection of risks and regulatory responsibilities that we've got to deal with. The HOA governing body should definitely include a position that's primarily focused on dam operation and maintenance. Don't let that just be a general thing that the board as a whole deals with. The HOA budget should include funds to cover normal operation and maintenance of the dam. And as has been mentioned, you need to have sufficient funds in reserve to cover unexpected or emergency maintenance or repairs. The last situation you want to get in is having something found to happen to your dam that requires some very quick emergency maintenance to be done that might cost you $25,000-$50,000, and you can't contract to have that done because you don't have the money in hand. So get those reserves built up. Next slide. Just a quick list of what's involved in dam operation and maintenance: adjusting lake levels, inspections, mowing, keeping the spillway and weirs clear of debris, preparing that EAP and keeping it updated, and lowering your lake level in anticipation of major rain events, monitoring the lake and dam during those events, and if necessary, implementing that EAP. Next slide. Who performs the operation and maintenance? Well, hopefully you've got some HOA representatives that are willing and able to perform and or coordinate the operation and maintenance activities. I think it's very important that you have a relationship with a registered engineer who is familiar with your dam to assist with inspections and repairs. Having somebody that's already familiar with your dam, if you need something urgent, you can call and deal with that urgent situation. Contractors. I also think it's a good idea to have a contractor who is familiar with your dam. Again, if you've got something urgent or critical that needs to be done, or a small job that's not worth going out for bid, that you've got a contractor you've got a relationship with and that you trust to come help you with something on your dam. Next slide. Controlling your lake level. Most lakes have some method for controlling the lake level. That may be stop logs in a weir. It may be some kind of gate or valves that's used to control the lake level and or to drain the lake. These things may require more than one person to physically operate. So it's a good idea to have several people that are familiar with this and able to help. If you've got a drop inlet like we do, it may require a boat or a ladder to access. May need to be secured to prevent unauthorized access. It needs to be periodically inspected and exercised. You don't want to let that equipment sit there for years and years, and then all of a sudden you've got to go out and release some water from your lake or drain the lake and find out the equipment won't operate. And then again, keep that weir and spillway clear of debris. Next slide. This is a picture of our drop inlet. Before the flood, we had to use a boat to access it. And if the lake level was down, you had to have some way to get up on top of that thing. So there you see, we put a ladder in place. I convinced our board to install the ramp you see on the right. That has been a godsend. There's times that me and others have had to be out there in the middle of the night making changes, adjustments, releasing water. And that's not a fun thing to do in the middle of the night by boat and clambering up on the drop inlet. Also note the locked gate we have and the warning signs. That doesn't keep all the kids from climbing around that and getting out there and playing, but at least it's something to discourage that. Next slide. If you have a control like this that requires a crank or a wheel or something to turn that's removable, you might consider purchasing a spare in case that one gets lost, stolen, dropped in the lake, and you need to operate the thing. It'd be good to have another one. Keep it somewhere other than at the weir. And you also need to leave it attached in case someone needs to operate that in an emergency. Next slide. Dam inspections. We all know that dams should be inspected periodically. You should be having a registered engineer inspect your dam annually, maybe every 2 years, depending on your particular dam and the inspections that you or someone with your HOA are able to do. I think frequent inspections by your HOA is critical to keeping up with what might be slowly changing conditions that you need to be aware of and catch before things get serious. Retain documentation of those annual inspections and address any issues identified in a timely manner. Things can be a lot less costly and difficult to deal with when you take care of them sooner than later. Next slide. Maintenance, others have mentioned vegetation, Dan Creed did. You need to maintain a healthy turf on earthen dams to prevent erosion. Keep the grass mowed to allow for effective inspections. If you've got 3 feet of standing grass and weeds on the dam, you're going to potentially miss some things that you need to see, erosion, boils, seepage, that kind of thing that you really need to be able to see in an inspection. And remove any woody vegetation before it can get established. Other things, maintain any erosion controls you've got on your dam, such as riprap or turf reinforcement. Those are there for a reason and are not effective if they get damaged. Quickly repair any damage done by burrowing animals. If you've dealt with beavers, muskrats, other things, they can quickly burrow into your dam and create damage that, if not dealt with quickly, can cause a big expensive problem. And then again, remove the debris that could impede flows over your spillway and weir. Next slide. Emergency action plans. Assign responsibility for your EAP to one HOA representative. Establish contacts and build a relationship with the folks at DHEC. Whether that be the central office folks or your regional engineer. DHEC does the difficult part of the EAP development in the inundation mapping. They provide you a draft plan that has that inundation map in it, but you've got to take that and complete it, including owner, operator, and contact information for potentially inundated properties downstream. It needs to be distributed once finished to the emergency response organizations and to other HOA representatives. And you need to update that plan with current contact information annually. Next slide. Preparing for emergencies. I was in this position the night of the flood in 2015. Was up most of the night watching our lake level rise to the point it was about to go over the top of our dam, making phone calls, trying to follow the plan that we had in place. But it helps to have multiple people familiar with that in case you're out of commission. Another fellow that was supposed to help, the power line came down, his phone was down, his cell phone wouldn't work. The other thing to do is register for a Code Red Emergency Notification Service. There's a link on the DHEC website to apply for that, send them the information, and they'll get you and others in your HOA signed up for that. Consider lowering your lake level in advance of major rain events and coordinate any water releases with the lakes or properties below you. One time we had a situation where we were gonna start releasing water, but the lake above us started dumping water on us so fast we couldn't pull the boards out of our weir. So it's good to coordinate that activity. And then monitor your lake and dam during and following major rain events. Next slide. In closing, now that you've put in all the hard work and effort into making sure your dam and lake are well managed, please relax and enjoy the many benefits our lakes afford us. We're fortunate to have our beautiful watersheds and our nature. So all this hard work we're doing, all that you've heard about tonight, all the worries and all, hopefully it's worth it in the end, and enjoy the lake. And that's it. Thank you.
Well, all right. Well, thank you. Thank you, Steve and everyone for all that valuable and all that great information that we've been, everyone's shared with us tonight. I'm going to just, right at 8 o'clock, we will be wrapping up here. Alicia, if you can hit the next, advance the slide. Continuing education units are available for anybody that's a registered certified community association manager, and so those are available. You have to fill out a course evaluation and provide your contact information, and those evaluations will be sent via email after tonight. Next slide, please. And again, you will receive an email with the evaluation, and just complete that by Wednesday. Well, that date's not
that's
right.
That's an outdated slide, and everybody will be getting it in the morning, and it'll be due by Friday.
Yeah, sure. Just follow the instructions in Alicia's email if you need those credits. All right, next slide, and I think that's it. On behalf of DHEC, thank you all for your participation tonight, and for all of y'all who have joined us in any of the other sessions that we've had. This is the last one, and we will be posting the recording to our DHEC website. If anyone still has questions, submit them after tonight. You can submit them via email to response@dhec.sc.gov, and we'll get back to you with respond to your questions. And with that, I think we're going to call it a night. And on behalf of FEMA, the National Dam Safety Program, Argonne National Lab, and all of our other presenters, just thank you very much, and have a good night.